If you watch the video on section 7.1, you're going to be pleasantly surprised with 7.2 because it's the same thing that we did in 7.1, only in 7.1 we had a standard normal distribution where the mean was 0 and the standard deviation is 1. This time we're just going to have any old normal distribution for a given mean and standard deviation. Our first objective is to convert values from a normal distribution to a z-score. Remember, the formula for z-scores is z equals x minus the mean divided by the standard deviation. Recall that z-scores of a data value represent the number of standard deviations that a data value is above or below the mean. If x is a value from a normal distribution with a mean mu and a standard deviation sigma, we can convert x to a z-score by using the method known as standardization. That's using this formula. For example, consider a woman whose height is 67 inches from a normal population with a mean of 64 inches and a standard deviation of 3 inches. Her height is above average, so we expect the z-score to be positive. If I drop this 67 in place of x in this formula, and then I subtract the mean and divide by the standard deviation, 67 minus 64 is 3, and 3 divided by 3 is 1. Looking at the graph of the standard normal distribution and the graph of a normal distribution where the mean is 64 and the standard deviation is 3, we see that a height of 67 inches matches up exactly with a standard deviation of 1. So we can either work with the distribution that we're given or convert it to a standard normal distribution. Consequently, everything we did in 7.1 with standard normal distributions, we can do with any normal distribution. Now I do have a question. Is it bothering anybody that these graphs look exactly the same when I told you that if you change the mean and the standard deviation, that's going to look slightly different? Do you remember in this section, just looking at this graph right here, I said if we change the mean and the standard deviation, it changes the shape of the graph. But I also said that every normal distribution has this basic shape. So rather than change the shape of the graph and keep this axis scale the same, what we did here was we kept the shape of the graph the same and changed the scale on the axes. Do you see that? That way we're looking at the same graph, the same shape. So whenever I ask you to draw a normal distribution, I don't care how you draw your distribution, just don't make it a triangle. You do want to draw pictures for these problems, try and make it look somewhat normal. I find them easier to draw if I start in the middle and go down to the left and down to the right. You do want to have pictures whenever you're working these problems. So objective 2 is to find the area under a normal curve. In this problem, we're going to read it and then draw a picture because we're not given a picture this time. A study reported that the length of pregnancy from conception to birth is approximately normally distributed with a mean of 272 days and a standard deviation of 9 days. As I was reading, I summarized this information symbolically so that I don't have to keep digging back into the problem for this information. Now here's our question. What proportion of pregnancies last longer than 280 days? This is a normal distribution. We were told it was a normal distribution. And if I want a picture to help me visualize the information, I need to start with a normal distribution. What number goes in the middle here for the mean? 272. 9 is your spread. That's your standard deviation. The mean goes in the middle here. I was asked to find the proportion of pregnancies that lasts longer than 280 days. That means I'm looking for x is greater than 280. Is 280 to the left or to the right of this 272? To the right, so it's going to be somewhere around here, 280. Greater than means I want to find the area to the right. So now I have a picture with my shaded region. Which function on your calculator did I tell you to use if you know the z-scores and you want the area? You know the z-scores, you want the area. Look at the table that you wrote. Normalcdf. If you look back at the table in your notes, if you know the z-scores and you want the area, you use the normalcdf. What number goes first? The left bound. Look at your shaded region. What is our left bound? 280. What is our right bound? This goes off to infinity, doesn't it? So I can use 1,000. I can't use 100 because now 100's not a big number. 100's actually less than our average. So I need a really big number to stand in the place of infinity. I'm going to use 1,000. And then what goes next? Normally, in 7.1 it was 0, but now our mean is 272 and our standard deviation is 9. Remember, these numbers are left bound, right bound, and when I say left and right, I'm talking about the leftmost part of your shaded region and the rightmost part of your shaded region. This right bound needs to be infinity. I don't have infinity, so I just use a really big number. And then here's the mean and the standard deviation that was given to me in the problem right here. When I put this into my calculator, I hit second vars number 2. The left bound is 280. The right bound is a really big number. The mean is 272, the standard deviation is 9, and that gives us 0.1870. What that means is approximately 18.7% of pregnancies last more than 280 days. Any question about what I have written in red? If I change that probability to a percent, it just means that I move that decimal over two places to the right. Objective 3 asks us to find the value from a normal distribution corresponding from a proportion. So here, we're told that Mensa is an organization whose membership is limited to people whose IQ is in the top 2% of the population. Assume that scores on an IQ test are normally distributed with a mean of 100 and a standard deviation of 15. Notice I summarize that information as I'm reading it. What is the minimum score needed to qualify for membership? Here we have a picture. They only accept the top 2%. We want to know what that IQ score is that separates the top 2% from the bottom 98%. We want to know what that IQ score is. What function would I use on my calculator, the Normalcdf or the inverse norm? We want an X. We know the area. Inverse norm. Now, what would I plug in for my area? Do I use the 0.02? This area is to the right of what I'm looking for. So I would do 1 minus 0.02, or you could put in 0.98, because that is 1 minus 0.02. The mean is 100, the standard deviation is 15. Then we go to our calculators, and we do second vars number 3. The area, I'm going to use 1 minus 0.02, even though I know that's 98. I just think it'll make it easier for you in the future. The mean is 100. Sorry, my area was 1 minus 0.02. The mean is 100. The standard deviation is 15. We put that in our calculator and we get 130.8. Now, if you know anything about IQ scores, you know they're measured using whole numbers. So that 130.8 we're going to record as 131. So that means in order to be accepted into Mensa, your IQ score has to be greater than 131. That wraps up section 7.2, and we are now done for the evening.